Hi, in this video we'll be introduced to some of the most basic facts about biology. Yes, you can see I've put universal in quotes because almost nothing in biology is universal, but there are a great deal of things that are true for 99.99% of life, and that's what we'll try and talk about here. So we'll talk about that DNA is the primary repository of information for life. A very fundamental fact. It's so fundamental it was referred to as the central dogma of biology. That is, DNA makes RNA makes protein. We'll see that DNA is organized into genes. Genes can code for proteins, which are made from the DNA via the intermediate molecule of mRNA, and that mRNA is interpreted by tRNA and ribosomes. And finally, that we share parts or genes with the simplest of life forms, which indicates that our genes are evolutionarily related. So in this course, we'll spend a lot of time talking about the three major types of molecules in cells: DNA, which, as we said, is the repository of information; proteins, which are structural elements and the molecular machines of the cell, the parts of the cell that do things; and then RNA is sort of the transition, the operating officer that converts the DNA information selectively into proteins, although more and more their functions for RNA are being found as well. So all information is stored in DNA. It's stored in a linear code of bases C, A, T, and G. And this code contains all the information to convert a single cell into a fully adult human being with something like 10 to the 12th cells. DNA is double-stranded, and it's in the conformation of a double helix, with the information-containing part, the bases, in the center, and on the outside, a sugar phosphate backbone. The information is passed on by cells by synthesis of new strands of DNA, and it uses the original strand of DNA as a template for guiding the incorporation of new nucleotides into a growing strand of DNA. As you probably well know, C's and G's always base pair with each other, and A's and T's always base pair with each other. DNA replication is semi-conservative, which is to say that each of the new daughter strands gets one of the original parent strands, and each of the new cells or copies of the DNA has one newly synthesized strand. These are in tan. Now, the central axiom of biology, which was historically named the central dogma of biology, but there's nothing religious about it, is that DNA makes RNA makes protein. And this is the direction of information flow. DNA replicates itself, a process called replication. Portions of DNA are converted to RNA in a process called transcription. And then the mRNA is converted to protein by a process called translation. And the information stored in nucleotides is converted to a string of 20 different amino acids that make up all proteins. Now, as we've said, when part of the DNA information is going to be converted into an action, it is transcribed into RNA, which makes multiple copies of a portion of a DNA. Here we can see blue, red, yellow, blue, red, yellow, as copies of blue, red, yellow of the original DNA strand. As we'll see in future videos, the RNA molecules are copies of the coding strand. They are synthesized using the template strand. Proteins are the molecular machines of the cell, and they also have structural functions. But in this example, we see an enzyme called lysozyme cleaving a polysaccharide into smaller units. There are portions of proteins called catalytic active sites, in which some reactive amino acids are brought into close proximity in order to affect this biochemistry at rates that far exceed what would be possible at room temperature without the enzymes. This slide shows tRNA molecules, which is the molecule which converts the nucleic acid code into the identity of an amino acid, which will then be incorporated into a protein as the instructions are read on a strand of messenger RNA. So this extends in both directions. The tRNA base pairs to the mRNA, just like the DNA double helix, assuring the proper positioning of that amino acid. On this slide, we see the steps of protein synthesis. And in particular, we have a 3-amino acid polypeptide chain that's going to grow into a 4-amino acid polypeptide chain. The ribosome will cleave the bond between an amino acid and the tRNA molecule in the P site, attaching it to an amino acid in the A site of the ribosome. You'll learn these site names in future lectures. After switching the connectivity of the polypeptide chain, the ribosome, the large subunit, will translate one codon. The small subunit will translate one codon to get back into register, and a new amino acid will enter into the A site. Although it's a simplification, there is a sort of a correspondence that's often talked about between one gene and one protein. On your DNA, you have genes arranged. Here they're depicted in red, arranged linearly with small yellow non-coding segments separating the genes. We'll see later on that genes can actually produce several variations of a protein, but that is a finer point. Organisms can have a wide number of genes. The smallest genomes of free living cells contain about 500 genes. Humans have somewhat greater than 20,000, and in fact, we'll usually use the interval between 20 and 25,000 genes. We don't know exactly yet, but it's probably somewhere in that range. The number of genes themselves is not necessarily an indicator of complexity, though it is certainly somewhat of a guide. This slide highlights that we share many molecular similarities with simple single-celled baker's yeast, which indicates that we are evolutionarily related, and features that are important tend to be conserved over very large evolutionary timescales. When discussing evolution, the DNA record is the molecular fossil you want to be looking at. Whenever someone is speaking to you about the fossil record and bones and either proving or disproving evolutionary theories, 99% of the time you can just stop listening because they're not talking about the most relevant information. Talking about bones and fossils in the 1800s was certainly acceptable. We weren't aware of any other information that bore on this. But you can clearly see the relatedness in the sequence between humans and baker yeast, and the relationship between these proteins is hard to ignore. These evolutionary relationships can be exploited to give us information about protein function and the relatedness of different organisms. On this slide, we see a phylogenetic tree comparing a number of proteins, myoglobins and hemoglobins, and the point being made is that the sequences are more related of all the hemoglobins than they are to the myoglobin species proteins, even though they have somewhat similar functions in that they bind oxygen. So the more closely related the sequence, the more closely related the function. So that concludes a whirlwind tour through some basics of biology, and I look forward to filling in the details through the rest of the semester.